Wednesday, but then it's going to become very wet and windy overnight. Thursday looks to be colder with some sunny spells, but the strong winds will remain a constant theme this week. BBC Southern Counties Radio Weather, I'm Georgie Palmer.
Now, Georgie, you've been very kindly helping us on the programme with our weightlessness feature.
Yes. Probably could, because my diet's so awful, I'm making everyone feel better.
It could be, but all we're asking is that listeners just make a note, a mental note, if you like, of everything that they've eaten over 24 hours. And you came up with something on Friday that hadn't occurred to me, which is what you found yourself doing is every time you eat something, thinking of me.
I know, well, because because you were asking me every day last week, I kept thinking, oh, Tommy's going to want to know about this.
It works, doesn't it, though?
It does. Okay. It does, actually. Thanks, Tommy.
Last 24 hours, then.
I had roast goose yesterday for lunch, which was a bit different. Never had goose before. Last night, I had some Marmite on toast, and this morning, I had a bagel with raspberry jam.
Very good.
I think. Well, I don't think it's that great, is it?
Well, it's impressive.
Is it?
What the goose thing is, anyway.
It was nice, actually.
Good. All right. Well, thank you again for that. Talk to you a bit later.
That's a pleasure. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Okay. Some fun and games here this afternoon, which I'm getting par for the course, aren't they, really? Let's see what happens if we try this. Oh, yes, you like that, Johnny, so much. You want to hear it again? I don't think so. Good afternoon and welcome to the afternoon show on BBC Southern Counties Radio. Tommy Boyd with you, an enormous deal in engineers. On the afternoon show this afternoon, got a chinwag a little bit later on, which is good fun. The Irritable Hour from 3 until 4 with... You know, January the 8th, 9th, 10th, it's just about the most irritating little clutch of days of the year, isn't it? Because Christmas is well and truly gone and the New Year's gone and the decorations are down and you're £4 overweight and you've got nothing to look forward to until February the 14th, which is Valentine's Day, and you don't get cards anymore, do you? No, nor do I. So it's a rotten old time of the year. So the Irritable Hour, I think, will be... probably quite sort of multicoloured. That's from 3 until 4. Talking about vitamins, you know, Have a look in your vitamin cabinet and have a look at all the vitamins that you've got in there, and but they're about two-thirds of the way through the jar and you gave up because it didn't make you feel any better, did they? We're also wondering this, you know, supposing you had the money, would you have sent your child to a private school? 0845957007. The beast of the day is a very unusual one, and I'll let you know what it sounds like in just a couple of seconds. But a miserable swine the beast is as well, and we must choose a monk snatch place too. It's BBC Southern Counties Radio. It's the afternoon show. It's 1:15.
Story. The world becomes a magical place.
15 knots. Steady as she goes, Lieutenant.
Wait. Something's happening.
What's going on, Lieutenant? Come on. Come on, talk to me.
Captain, the temperature of the water's dropping. It's getting cold about the second. What should we do?
Come on. Time to pull the plug out.
But, Dad, what happens to the submarine?
The water's getting cold. You'll have to wait until tomorrow's bath.
Stories make the world magical. If you need to improve your reading and writing skills to tell better stories, call Roar on 0800 150 950 for your free guide.
So, Beast of the Day. Now, I think this noise is reasonably easy. Most people listening will probably work out what this animal is. Can you? That's the beast of the day. It is a beast too. 0845957057. Play it a couple more times quickly, but I think it's reasonably easy, or is it? I don't know. Actually, no, it's not. It's always the way. When you know the answer to something, you think to yourself, well, any fool could get that. But I'm trying to put myself in your place, and you haven't heard this before, and you haven't seen what's written on the box. Yeah. You can narrow it down. I reckon you can probably guess which sort of vague umbrella species it is. But that is the beast of the day. And what is the beast of the day? And then once we find out what the beast of the day is, we're going to be down on it like a ton of bricks. Because it's about time we started bullying this one back. Seriously. And vitamins, what have you got in your cabinet? What is ginkgo biloba? What is that? What is spirulina? What is that? We've got that. What is ginseng? It's some kind of a root, isn't it? I lived on it for about 3 or 4 years. I can't honestly say it made the slightest bit of difference. Do we really need them? We've all got tubfuls of them. My wife's got something called flash fighters. Huh? Well, St. John's wort. Does that work? You know. 0845957057 is the number. And there's that question that we're going to be getting into as the show develops, without getting too heavy, because it is the afternoon show. But supposing you had the money so that you had a complete choice in the matter, would you send your school, your son, your child, your daughter, would you send your child to any kind of a private school for any kind of reason? That makes it a richer question, doesn't it? To any kind of a private school for any kind of a reason. 08459 570057.
The Sound of Sussex. BBC Southern Counties Radio.
That's McFadden and Whitehead. Or is it McFadden and Whitehead? Because, you know...
BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel.
No, it's not. No. Okay, so the car's driving the guy. That's no problem at all. We've been there. What was I going to say? Oh, yeah. McFadden and Whitehead, it's pronounced, but it had to be McFadden. Do you go back that far? Like the Dionne Warwick thing? 30 years on, she finally says, yeah, it's Warwick. You know, let's go to Stephen, who's called the show from Newbury. Hello, Stephen.
Hello there.
Hello there.
Hello. How are you?
So well. It's ridiculous. I feel ashamed. How about you?
Not too bad at all, thank you. Not too bad.
Splendid.
Pretty good.
Good. And you called because? Do some of the work here. I'm busy.
Hey? Hey, well, no, I'm on my lunch break, so...
Lovely. So I wish I was.
There you are. No, I've called because the beast of the day.
The beast of the day. Right, hold on. It's... Come on. Yes, this one. It was fairly easy, wasn't it?
No, it wasn't too bad. I'm a twitcher anyway.
I did not know you were a twitcher.
So I don't know where it came from.
There it goes again, you see?
There you are.
BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel.
I'm just going to let the girl have a moment because...
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's bring the guys in. We'll have a chat. Mark can come in. Nick.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, we just need some of these green arrows moving around a little bit, guys, if you get a moment.
Yeah.
Now, you stay there, Stephen, if you can. We'll have
I will.
How are you, Mark?
I'm tip top.
Well, that'd be a bit better if I was doing the show from bloody Blackpool.
The town going back up there if it's like this late.
Don't you start laughing when we're having a meeting without you, Stephen.
No.
Anyway, where were we? Oh, yes, the swan. Correct, it is the swan. And you're a twitcher, but you've got no idea why...
No idea what it's called.
How long you been bird watching then?
Ever since I was tiny, really. Sort of like probably about 6-7 years old.
Oh, so your dad did it or something?
Yeah.
How is your dad?
He passed away in 1990, I'm afraid. So,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, but I've got rather a big family. I've got three brothers and three sisters, so...
Wow.
Quite a big family.
And mum?
Mum's still alive. She's 86 this year, bless her.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay, and what are you up to at the moment? You say you're on your lunch break. From what?
I drive excavators, 360 earth-moving machines.
Beautiful. How butch can you get?
Well, it's not that bad. They're a lot easier than they used to be. So, you know, you're sat there sort of like... it's like being sat in an armchair just twiddling a few levers. It's not
you say it's easier than it used to be. You must always have had power steering in something that big.
Oh, well, yeah, you have, yeah. It's on, like I'm saying, I'm on a track vehicle, so it's a Caterpillar. At the moment, it's a 5-ton machine I'm driving, so, yeah, it's only a smallish machine, but it moves quite a bit of earth in a day, so...
How often do you get out bird watching?
Not as often as I'd like. At the moment, I'm working in Sunningdale at the moment, and by the time I get here in the morning and then drive home at night, it's dark, so... It's only the weekends, really.
What's the earth you're moving? Is it a building thing or landscaping or something?
Yes, building at the moment. We're landscaping around the house.
Oh, okay.
And yes, it's quite a big thing. So
I'll tell you what, you say house, there are some palaces in Sunningdale.
Yes, there are. It's quite a big place.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
And how long do you get for lunch? An hour?
Only half an hour, so.
Yeah, you see, where's the hour lunch break gone?
There you are, exactly. Where has it gone?
And what about double bubble? I don't suppose there's any more of that around, is there?
No, there isn't. It's flat rate and that's it.
Are you self-employed or do you...
I am self-employed, yes.
Now, a mate of mine who's a plasterer was telling me that there's, you have to pay up front now, even if you're self-employed, about 18%. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. You've got a card called CIS card and they take it at source, so take your tax at source.
And is it the same as if you were PAYE, or is it a little bit less?
It's a little bit less, and you still have to pay once your accounts go in.
So you
the
do
sort
get
of remainder, if there's any, you know, all depends. Like I do, I work for other people as well, not just for one company.
So everybody wins except you, we still need accountants, because they wouldn't have had that, would they, all you self-employed builders that had to go off and do it more or less PAYE, because that does them out of a...
Well, that's right, it does, yeah.
An annual £250, something like that, for an accountant, just to check the books, is it?
About 320 mine was last.
Yeah, it's usually around about that, isn't it?
Yeah.
Still, fair enough, it's got to be a day and a half for them, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah, really. It has, yeah.
And when were you last out bird watching?
Like I say, not before Christmas. It was well before Christmas, so that was the last time.
Yeah, it's filthy out there at the moment, isn't it?
Because it's not very nice. It's just starting to rain again now.
I don't mind it being fierce.
No.
But when it's just cold and damp like this and wet...
No, it's not really nice.
We had to put the wheelie bins out this morning and it was a horrible job because it went up your sleeves. So what do you know about the swan then? Because we're down on the swan. We reckon that the swan has had far too much undeserved good PR for the last 150 years. It's about time we squared things off with the swan because they're bullies, aren't they?
They can be. I mean, they only stick up for themselves anyway. It's the same, I mean, I've been attacked by geese, even just walking straight past them, you know, Canada geese, so...
Well, it's the same thing, isn't it, really? Geese and swans?
A little bit smaller a goose. Not as big as a swan, but...
Is that about the size of it? A goose is just a smaller swan. So so is a swan a member of the goose family?
No, I don't think it is. No,
is it
I think it's a member of the swan family itself, and that's it, I think.
Right.
As far as I know, the geese, there are so many different species of geese.
Yeah.
And so many different species of swans. So I think they are, you know.
And do they still transport you to Australia in chains if you kill one?
I don't think so.
It used to be protected, didn't it? It was a royal thing.
Yeah, I don't know if that's just the black swan or the whole swans in general, but you're right. I think they did used to be protected.
Only Henry VIII was allowed to eat them.
That's it. That's very true.
And they've had fantastic PR from that Danny Kaye thing, haven't they?
Yeah, they have. But I mean, no, I've hand fed swans. I mean, even at Reading, at Caversham Bridge.
You're asking for it.
And I've hand fed them. I mean, they're not that bad.
Every dad who's ever lived will tell his son at some point, don't get too close to a swan. They can break your arm with one beat of their wing. We all tell our sons that. We don't know if it's true or not, but we all tell them that.
I think they could do, yeah, possibly. They are very, very strong, yeah.
And do you know what? I find them quite intimidating. They almost look as though they're angry. It's something about the configuration of their markings above the eyes. They look angry, don't they?
Yeah,
all the time.
They do, yeah. I mean, I've been on a boat fishing. This was at the lakes in Thatcham.
Yeah.
And a swan has literally got in the boat to try and get me out.
See what I mean? They're thugs. They are the thugs of the wildlife kingdom. They are thugs.
They are, really, I suppose, yeah.
Aren't they thugs? They're upper-class thugs.
They are, yes. They sort of preen themselves, fluff themselves up and then come at you, saying, look at me, I'm going to have you, basically.
Anyway, I've just got one thing for you to leave you with, because we're talking about the swan and we're talking a little bit about birds, because it's always interesting.
Yeah. Yeah.
I found out something today I did not know about birds, which you might not. If you did, then you can confirm it, because it sounds weird. If you didn't, then, well, you've learned something.
I'll tell you. Yeah.
You know bird poo, which is white?
Yeah.
Apparently, it's not bird poo.
Is it not?
No, it's bird urine.
Ah, right, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and the reason bird urine is solid is because their system, their digestive system, retains as much moisture as it can. For the sake of efficiency, so birds don't have to go and drink too often, you see.
Oh, right.
And rather than waste good moisture in the urine, it's kind of creamed off before it's got rid of, and hence the reason why it's almost solid. And I think it's not uric acid, which is what is mostly in urine, something like that, but it's almost solid urea or something like that.
Oh, right. Oh, I didn't know that.
No, isn't that interesting?
Didn't know that at all. No,
vaguely
interesting. All these years of bird watching, and I didn't know that.
Oh, no, you made me feel good.
I watched the bird, not the poo.
That's true enough. True enough. Well, lovely talking to you. Your lunch break's up, isn't it? But thank you for spending part of it with us. Good lad.
Well, thank you very much indeed.
Cheers, that's Stephen.
Bye.
On his earth mover in Newbury, and he's quite right. This is the beast of the day, which is a swan. What do we know about swans? A text has flooded in, Jenny Day. Can you read it in this half light?
I can. This is like candlelight. It's very eveningy, this, isn't it? Thomas turned all the lights out.
With the place in the dark and in the spare radio studio bunker. It's a bit like World War II. I'm not sure whether to do the whole thing as Lord Haw-Haw.
Siege mentality. Where are the chimneys of Colby?
Guildford calling.
No, thank you. I just wanted to say, texts have flooded in. Darren and Staines knew instantly. It was a mute swan in flight. Well, mute swan, am I being stupid here? Would they make that noise? If they were mute.
Can I say that you not only do that sound well, but your bodily impression of a swan is fairly authentic.
Do you know, I think if I were a beast, I might be a swan.
Oh, dear.
It's not good, is it?
No, they're upper class thugs.
I know, a bit snappish.
Yes.
I've got a long, long neck.
Yeah, you have got a long neck.
A lot of furious activity going on underneath the surface.
Yes.
What a bit bully. I don't think I'm a bully, but I think there are some similarities. Gary in Biggin Hill says it's a swan. It sounded like one flying low overhead. I saw a swan this morning. It looked rather like Concorde taking off, because it looks very hard work for them to fly, doesn't it? And T from Dorking is the beast of the day, a swan in flight. Well, so that was easy.
Well done, everybody, you got the swan. Now, we found out a bit about bird deposits. The next question is this: why are eggs egg-shaped? And see, I know the answer.
I'm not answering. Well, it's something to do.
BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel. Tommy Boyd on BBC Southern Counties Radio.
We'll take a tune from you-know-who's brother, one of the celebrity Big Brother people, Jermaine, him. And then it's our Monk Snatch place of the day, where we pull somewhere out of our machine, a place, a village, a town, could be a city. We've got two of them, in Sussex, Surrey or North East Hampshire, and then pool our resources. Jackson and Billie Jean. It's the afternoon show on BBC Southern Counties Radio at nearly 20 to 2. A good afternoon. Where did we get to? We've got, where are we?
We're Swans.
What's your name? Who am I?
Right now, it's Monday.
It's welcome to Git FM. And what?
It's Tommy Boyd and Jenny Day, and we're talking about swans, aren't we? No, and we're about to launch our Monk Snatch place of the day.
Fleet.
Watling, Hoe, Crookham Village, Bexhill, Odiham, Stenning, Mile Oak, Holton,
Southwick,
Ash,
Hotswade Village, Cullen, Sussex, Alfie, Godalming,
I'm all right for saying Godalming, stop. I've never said it in my life yet.
We have one. Ramsing, Westmack,
Wygate, Anstey, Southam, Forest Row, Copsale Street, Weston, Mackerel's Common, Pevensey, Farnham, Hazelmere, Alfiston, Battle, Crowhurst, Eastbourne, Husband Zoo, Ringmer, Rye, Seaford, Uckfield, Wadhurst, Heathfield, Ditchling, Amberley, Chidham, Warnham, Newark, Angering, Whiston, Arundel, Goring by Sea.
Get ready.
Frant, Framber, Bramber even, Lingfield, Loughton, Barnum, Bucks Green, Cocking, Dial Post, West Wittering, Hickstead, Yapton, Woodmancott, Up Marden, Storrington,
Okay,
I bet it's going to be Godalming.
Aldo, Halnecker. Halnecker.
Halnecker.
Which is a fantastic sounding place. It really sounds as though the Valkyries should come flying out of turrets at dusk in Halnecker.
You know, it sounds like a breed of swan.
It sounds like somewhere just to the left of Hades. Go down to Hades, turn left, all right? Don't go first right, that's hell. Carry on. Next right, that's Halnecker. That's what it sounds like to me.
And people go around in black cloaks. That's the uniform there.
That's it. That's it. And they hum Wagner.
Yes.
In Halnecker.
Or do they? Don't be offended if you live in Halnecker. It sounds like we should say it in a funny accent as well. Yes. Well, I have no idea about that at all. So that's going to be really, really interesting. We want to know all about it.
So where is Halnecker and what goes on in Halnecker, and do they still burn witches and so on? So Jan Wellsman has emailed on the Ruth Kelly story. We're not going to obviously focus at all on the private aspects of that, because the child has a life to live regardless. And it's more a broad kind of issue. So just wondering whether you thought about sending your child to private school. You've got to think about it, I think. You've got to think about it occasionally, particularly if on those days when, and it happens to every child, they come home and you're beginning to wonder whether such and such a teacher and such a school, and you think to yourself, well, what are the alternatives? And private education is something that runs through your mind. Jan said, I'd only send my child to a private school if it was near the child's home community and if they liked it. My husband was sent to a boarding school for the blind in Exeter, and he lived in Farnborough. It was thought best at the time, but he was separated from family and local friends. And when he came home during the holidays, he didn't have any friends to be with, and he felt a visitor in his own home. He feels a real loss and lack of belonging to anywhere. It didn't help his learning either, because he was unhappy. That's so true. It's important. You can't learn if you're fed up. He says, Jan goes on, we all want what's best for our children. Yeah. So you can't blame anyone for doing this just because they have the money or the need to do this. If education for the masses is not up to standard or can't cope with individual needs, then people have to do what they think is best. We shouldn't be afraid to want a high standard of education when this is what will be our future investment, well-educated children. So thanks for that, Jan. 08459 570057. Also wondering what you've got. Oh, here's an email from Fiona. In your vitamin cabinet. Most of us have got kind of a vitamin cabinet now. We used to keep either herbal teas in it, didn't we? Or the Elastoplast. Silly name. But nowadays, it's got some half-empty jars of fancy vitamins in it. What is Jinking Balboa? He sounds like he's about to have his last fight, doesn't he? Hey? We'll get to Fiona's email about education shortly. Maggie's on the line from Littlehampton on the Beast of the Day. Hello, Maggie.
Hello. Miserable day, isn't it?
It is actually miserable. I hate to go on about the weather, but this morning, putting the wheelie bin out, I caught a little piece of ivy and it dropped about, oh, I don't know, only an egg cup full of freezing cold rain up my sleeve. And
it's horrible, isn't it?
I just
it's strange, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I've got a question about swans.
Okay.
We live in Littlehampton and we drive on the back road past Fall Prison to Arundel. And the swans from Littlehampton and Arundel, not all of them, but some of them, overwinter on the fields just outside Arundel. And every year, in two or three fields, you see half a dozen swans, and then they all seem to congregate on one field for about 3 months.
Yeah.
And I just wondered why, and how they choose a field.
I'm not saying you're short-sighted, but you're sure they're not just sheep?
No. Absolutely sure.
I just asked.
So they've been there for years. We've lived here 10 years, and they've been doing it. Yes, the swans. Sometimes they're right close to the road. You can, you know, pull up the car. People stop and photograph them and things. Okay. They're definitely swans.
And they just basically live on the ground during the winter.
They live on the ground. Yes.
Oh, God.
There's probably sort of, I don't know, 150, 200 of them. And they always have one field, but a different field each year.
Yeah.
But always in the same area. And I just wondered why. It's not all of the swans. There's always a few at Arundel and there's always some on the river at Littlehampton. But a vast majority of them overwinter on the fields.
Okay, well, I think that's a really good question. I can't guarantee at all that anybody listening will have a clue, but you never know.
Right, okay.
If not, somebody will phone and make something up. You know what people are like.
They are. I'd love to know why.
All right, thank you, Maggie.
Okay, thanks, then.
Cheers.
Bye.
Bye-bye. It's Maggie in Littlehampton with a question about the swan, which is the beast of the day, which is why... what did she say? She lives in Littlehampton, takes the back road to Arundel. Was that right? Was I paying attention? Yes. And she's wondering why this group of swans appear to winter in the same field every year. And as far as she knows, don't even bother to get off the ground at all, just for a little bit of exercise. They can find all the worms, I suppose. I mean, why do swans need to fly? They can swim. They can swim on the surface anyway. They can get bugs and grubs underneath the water and on the fields. There's no need for them to fly at all. They're just showing off. 2:15. It's the afternoon show. I'll make you laugh in a second, but I've had mine. Ron's on the line on swans. Hello, Ron.
Hello, Tommy. Yeah. I hate swans. This particular episode caused me so much trouble. It wasn't true. I was taking my dog for a walk. At one time, used to be a park underneath Kingston Bridge.
Yeah.
You may know Kingston, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
River Thames, going towards Hampton Court, took my dog for a walk. It was between May and June, because the fishing season on the course fishing doesn't start till the 16th of June. So there were no anglers about. So I'm walking along with my dog, going toward Hampton Court on a very early Sunday morning.
Yeah.
In the car that my father had bought me, I'm only 20 years old at this particular time. We're talking the late 60s. And we're wandering along, my dog and I, and all of a sudden, in front of me is a swan.
Yeah.
And I'm wandering along, and the swan looked at me, and I looked at the swan, and the swan suddenly, you know, it went into aggressive mood.
Yeah.
The wings came out.
Yeah.
The neck came out, it hissed.
Pulled himself up to his foot. They can get up to 4.5 feet tall.
That's right, yeah. And also, the wings are about four foot wide at least. And it suddenly looked at me and it charged.
Dear God.
It charged at me. And my dog, was minding its own business, spotted this, and grabbed hold of it by the neck, which wasn't difficult. And the swan ended up dead. It was an English bull terrier. Not one of them pit bulls or whatever they are, but a proper English bull terrier. Yeah. And he sort of shook it and killed it. Now, we're about 7 o'clock in the morning, on a Sunday morning, I think, bloody hell, he's killed one of the Queen's birds,
yeah,
which had actually attacked me.
Mm.
And,
death is a penalty, I believe, at least it was.
Well, that's what I thought at the time, yeah, because I've only 20 years old.
A Coldstream guard or somebody had seen you.
So I had to grab hold of the dog,
yeah,
put him back on his lead,
yeah,
drag him back to the car,
yeah,
walk was curtailed, got back home and couldn't contain myself, told my father, you should be a bloody fool, you should have brought the bloody bird back with you, you could have eaten it.
Well, I was going to say, I mean, the walk was curtailed and so was the swan's life.
Exactly, but it's a swan's
So you left it there?
Oh, yeah.
For the magpies?
Yeah, we left it, yeah, definitely, yes. Yeah, okay. Because I was... But, I mean, they do that, yes, don't they? Swans are horrible birds.
Bullies.
They look lovely when they're swimming about, I must admit, but they're nice birds.
Upper-class thugs. I'm grateful for your call, Ron. I think it illustrates what we all know, but very seldom choose to say, for whatever reason, because it probably seems disloyal to the throne. But we're not crazy about swans. 08459 570057. Richard's on the line from Feltham. Hello, Richard. Whereabouts in Feltham are you?
Hello, Tommy. Well, at the moment, I'm actually going past Guildford in my lorry, but I actually live on the Middleton border between Middleton and Feltham.
Very nice. Very pretty.
No. Tommy, it's about Hanukkah. It's pronounced Hanukkah, not Hanukkah, Hanukkah.
No, that's a Jewish festival.
Well, no, it's spelt differently. No, the L is silent.
Okay, I'll buy that.
Right, now, the other thing I was going to say, I need a bit of help on this one, but there is a famous landmark there called Hanukkah Mill. It's an old windmill. It's not actually working anymore, but it's sitting up there on the downs. Now, I believe that one of our famous literary people actually wrote a poem about it. Now, it was a guy who lived in Slindon in Bleak House. Was that Edward Lear? I can't remember. One of the other listeners will probably be able to tell you.
Did Edward Lear live in Bleak House? Asks Richard from the Feltham-Middleton borders. Yeah, okay.
It was one of our famous literary people. Somebody will ring up all indignant and say I got it wrong. But I know that Hanukkah Mill was actually mentioned, and I think Hanukkah Mill can actually be seen from the sea, but I'm not sure.
Okay, well, that's good stuff. Thank you for that. Where have you been today, then, if you're based right down on the seaside?
I've been all over South London. I deliver things.
Do you? Yeah. Do you? What's the traffic like, then? So you say South London. What are we talking about here?
Oh, we're talking about South London, Croydon, and Streatham, anywhere around
there. Streatham?
Yeah.
The one-way system in Streatham.
Lovely, isn't it?
And the Romans think they've got problems with their roads. That one way, just put a motorway through that common, I say.
Yeah, absolutely right.
Absolutely. But I'd never see traffic, a dog on it.
Traffic was absolutely dreadful. But
horrible.
It's back, isn't it?
I know. You see, the thing is, we're all back now.
Yes.
Some people, I've not met any, but I could tell from the state of the roads, an awful lot of people made a whole week of it last week.
Oh, it's just getting longer, isn't it? I mean, Christmas will be running for about 6 months before too long.
Who are all these people who can turn a bank holiday Monday into a full week? How does that work?
I really don't know, to be honest.
They're not paid by the hour or the day, are they, like the rest of us?
No, they certainly are.
I don't know. Well, you drive safely anyway, and thank you for your information about Hanukkah.
All right then, Tommy. Thank you very much.
Cheers. That's Richard, then, from Feltham, and he says it's not pronounced Hanukkah, it's pronounced Hanukkah, rather like, I believe, a Jewish feast. But he found himself wondering out loud whether Edward Lear lived in Bleak House. So it's we're sort of playing past the parcel a little bit this afternoon. It's the afternoon show, the weather's really appalling. Just nothingy, cold, damp, nothingy, not bleak enough to be Macbeth. And interesting, it's dull, boring. Dull in terms of light and dull in terms of boring out there. So we're just faffing on the radio. Terry's lives in the next village along from Hanukkah. Is that right, Terry?
Hello, yes, it is.
What village would that be?
It's Eartham. It's just 2 miles the other way,
yes,
towards Fomwell. I live between Fomwell and Goodwood. And you, if you know Goodwood Races, yes?
God, yes.
Well, if you're going along the main road from, if you'd actually go through my village if you're going from Fontwell Races.
Right.
You would drive through my village to go to Goodwood.
Right.
And
that must be a very lovely...
Instead of going up the hill, if you turned left,
yeah,
as if you're going then back to Chichester, you drive through, and it is pronounced Hanukkah.
It is it? Why would that be?
I don't know, it's just that I just know it is the way it's pronounced.
Is that the local...
Isn't it?
Well, see, sometimes the local pronunciation isn't correct.
Yeah, here it is, Hanukkah.
But maybe that's not the right way to pronounce it. What is a Hanukkah? We don't know, do we?
No, I don't. I'm not at home, so I can't look it up either. But it is the windmill as well. But if you're up on the top road going towards Goodwood, you can see Hanukkah windmill.
Very nice.
It isn't a working windmill, but it's a pleasant walk up there. And I believe...
Yes?
Years ago, there was an old Hovis advert, I think, done from there, going down on this bicycle.
No, that was meant to be north of Bolton, wasn't it?
No, I'm sure there was also an advert done from... there.
Is that right?
And I heard your previous listener mention Bleak House at Slindon.
Yes.
I believe he may be right on that point, because I'm sure there's a plaque on the wall of Bleak House.
Right.
Saying about it.
Good stuff.
I know I used to work in the house years ago.
What did you used to do there?
Well, I was a gardener. I am a gardener still.
Fantastic.
But, I worked there, but it is pronounced Hanukkah. But it's a beautiful view from Goodwood. You can see it down on a lovely day, the windmill. We just take children up there to have picnics.
Do you know what? I honestly think that the view from Goodwood, I don't think there's a better view in this country of ours.
No, I have to admit, I've never actually been to the races, although I've lived in this Eartham for 24 years.
Oh,
but,
you should get up to Goodwood for the races, I can tell you, or the golf or whatever, because...
It's beautiful. I mean, it is the most beautiful race course in the country, I think.
First of all, I tell you why it's good going racing at Goodwood. I don't know how they managed to do it, but you can always get served. You go up to the bar, and somebody comes towards you and says, what can I get you? Unbelievable, in this day and age, which I never say. And then you take your drink, and you walk just a little bit away from the race course, and you look down, you can see the Isle of Wight, and the Chichester Plain, and the sparkling sea, and the other way...
Absolutely, because you look down on Singleton as well. It is beautiful. Absolutely,
it's a great spot.
On a lovely day.
And if you've won...
It is nice, and Hanukkah's just a small place. As you go through Hanukkah, you've got a crossroads that would take you to Goodwood House,
uh-huh.
And you take the left turn in, which would take you to Boxgrove Village.
And we love Boxgrove, that's beautiful. Yeah, that's beautiful as well. Thank you for that little tour in our minds of serious beauty spot. You're a good man.
I enjoy your show, thank you very much.
Isn't it? I enjoy it sometimes. No, I enjoy it all the time. I think that's fairly obvious. So now, we've done some research, or maybe we've been taking phone calls from people who are in a bit of a rush, so they can't come to air. Jenny tells me on my machine that there is a poem called Hanukkah Mill. And Dave rang in to say that the Hovis advert, or at least one that he can remember, was filmed in Shaftesbury in Dorset. Isn't that interesting? Because the whole point of that Hovis ad was that it was north. You remember the music? Ba-na-na-na-na. What is that again? Bach? Pass. But he says it was filmed in Shaftesbury, and the last caller, Terry, there, thought that it was filmed right in the middle of our patch in Hanukkah. 08459 570057. It's the afternoon show. It's BBC Southern Counties Radio. I'm Tommy Boyd. Jenny Day is extremely busy. Good afternoon to you listening.
To make an appointment, press 5.
To leave a message, press 9.
To complain about our customer satisfaction representatives, press 1. #292740*6. Twice.
To get results,
what is going on?
Email Uncle Gordon.
Could they explain to our listeners what their policy is? I just wish they'd respond to our requests as quickly as they responded to criticism. So could we get this sorted out? If not, then we'll get through to head office.
If you've a consumer problem or need a helping hand from Uncle Gordon, email fixit@bbc.co.uk.
We'd like to know why this is happening.
Uncle Gordon, solving your problems on BBC Southern Counties Radio.
When you're in love with a beautiful woman, you watch your friend.
Watch your friend, you better watch your friend, you better look out.
When you're in love with a
And How We Men Love That Song, because it's slightly saucy, isn't it? I won't go back and embarrass anybody. It's nearly 2 o'clock. It's time for the news and the weather and the travel on BBC Southern Counties Radio. They're staying with the phones and you and the emails and text. Our beast of the day is the swan, if you can top that up. Our place of the day is Hulnecker, apparently pronounced Hanukkah. Did Edward Lear live in Bleak House? Around the corner from the mill in Hanukkah? And did they film the Hovis advert there? How about the vitamins in your cabinet? And if you had the money, would you have sent your child to private school?
Bexhill, Horsham, Haywards Heath, Billingshurst, Brighton, the sound of Sussex. BBC Southern Counties Radio.
They've bought in the charge.
What we're trying to do here is really avoid the head in the sand syndrome, where people put bills to the back of cupboards and don't really address these issues. What's important here is we're taking vulnerable customers out of the equation. So those that really are in financial difficulties and can't pay bills, we're going to protect them from this. This is about those that can pay but don't pay.
You're up to date with BBC Southern Counties Radio. It's 4 minutes past two.
BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel.
Well, better news regarding Henfield Road at Upper Beeding. The accident's been cleared and traffic's returned to normal. Bracknell at Ringmead. Traffic's also much better now. That accident's been cleared. But the traffic light's still out on Carlisle Parade at Hastings. That's the A259 near to the junction with White Rock Road. Engineers are still hopefully on their way. Public transport running well at the moment. Cass, don't forget, of course, the replacement bus service continues to run on South West Trains and Southern between Fratton and Portsmouth. You can update us on 08459 570057. I'm Chris Lambert, BBC Southern County. Radio Travel.
Are you having any luck, Chris, with that £7 that you told us that you thought you might quite like to shed?
Well, I haven't had any chocolate today.
No?
So that's a start.
Do you like your chocolate?
I do. I just realised my stomach's got enormous in apparently a 24-hour period sometime over Christmas.
Yeah. Mm. So what have you eaten over the last 24 hours, if you can remember?
I have just had, I've just had a chicken mayonnaise sandwich.
That's right.
Well, mayonnaise is a bit thing, isn't it?
It is.
I've got a bag of salt and vinegar crisps in my bag down here, but I haven't eaten them yet. Mm. Last night, I had quite a healthy salmon stir fry.
Excellent.
Mm.
Well, I think that probably allows you the old bag of crisps and the bit of mayo, don't you
think?
But
I'll keep you updated.
Are you actually trying to lose those £7, or are you sort of kidding yourself by occasional stir-fry?
No, I think maybe I should.
Okay.
Now that we've actually broadcast it to the nation.
Let's go for it.
All right,
let's, shall we? All right,
okay.
Mate. All
right, I better get some scales.
Yeah. Have you not got scales?
No, I weighed myself at my parents'.
Good for you. All right. Chris Lambert there. He's a good lad. He's our travel man, usually, in the afternoons. In case you're wondering what this is about, we've hit on this thing called weight listeners. Like, you know, weight watchers. Yeah, yeah. Well, all you do is you make a note, a mental note of everything that you eat. Everything that you eat. Every handful of nuts or every apple, okay? Because I reckon there are an awful lot of things that we eat because we just think, oh, well, I'm bored and I've got nothing to look forward to the next half hour, so I'll have a biscuit or I'll have a piece of chocolate or something like that. And you find that if you note down everything that you eat, it does make you think twice about popping some things in your old gob. And Georgie, who does the weather, is saying exactly the same thing. She now thinks to herself, if I eat this, I'm going to have to say it out loud on the afternoon show. And the same with Chris, and the same with myself, and the same with Jenny. So if you're still thinking in terms of wanting to drop 2 or 3 pounds, we're not going for broke here, unless you are lucky enough to be seriously overweight. We're only thinking about maybe 3 pounds and keeping those pounds off, all right? Between now, this week, and next week, end of next week, we're aiming to do it just by keeping an eye on what we eat and making a list. Only 24 hours on 24, okay? 08459 570057. Still looking for information about our place of the day, which is Hulnecker, or Hanukkah, if you live there, and our beast of the day, which is the swan. We had Ron on earlier, whose dog killed a swan. Ron made it perfectly clear that it was the swan's fault. But they are potentially dangerous, certainly dangerous-looking animals, aren't they? So what do we think about our beast of the day, which is the swan? Here's your weather. Dry and bright start some of us had this morning, but as the afternoon kicks in, the winds are becoming stronger and gustier. They're saying it's milder later, but I don't think so in that wind. Maximum temperature 12 centigrade, 54. Tonight, cloudy, exceptionally mild, with a little rain or drizzle at times. Strong southwesterly winds. Minimum 11 centigrade, 52 Fahrenheit. Tuesday, tomorrow, cloudy, very mild, rain at times. Strong southwesterly winds easing down. Maximum 14 centigrade, nearly 60 Fahrenheit, that is. Wow. Outlook for Wednesday to Friday, rain slowly clearing on Wednesday, becoming wet and very windy overnight, colder Thursday, sunny spells, scattered showers, but very windy, and yet more rain and strong winds on Friday.
Tommy Boyd on BBC Southern Counties Radio.
Going to be meeting a guest, a new friend we haven't met yet, in about 10 or 15 minutes time when we have our chin wag, so kettle on for that. Jennifer has emailed on the vitamins that everybody has lying around. We don't throw them away and we don't take them. We work our way about halfway or more through the jar, realise that we don't feel any better and therefore switch from spirulina to ginkgo biloba to ginseng. Ginkgo biloba, says Jennifer, is a herb, not a vitamin, and is supposed to help circulation and is thought to be a memory enhancer. I was in a trial for it in Guildford with quite a large group, and overall, she says, sadly, the results were inconclusive. That's Ginkgo biloba. 08459 570057. Beast of the day, place of the day is Halnecker. Anybody any idea why it should be pronounced Hanukkah, which I thought was a Jewish feast, as opposed to Halnecker? A lot of places in Sussex anyway, the residents like to pronounce the place where they live differently from how everybody pronounces it, because that way they kind of know they're amongst friends. That's how, if I want to ingratiate myself in a pub in Chichester, I pronounce it Chidester. Well, I've got another way of ingratiating myself in a pub in Chichester, but you won't know about that. Elton John at 2:10 on the afternoon show. This is I Want Love. I Want a Sonic Screwdriver.
I want love, but it's impossible. A man like me, so irresponsible. A man like me is dead in places. Other men feel liberated. And I can't love, shot full of holes. Don't feel nothing, I just feel cold. Don't feel nothing, just old scars.
John. Why do the Americans call the bathroom the John? No one knows. Angela is in Arford, and she knows a thing or three about the swan, which is the beast of the day. How are you today, Angela?
Very well, thank you, Tommy. Just ringing to tell you about the day we rescued a swan, or helped to rescue one. We were travelling southbound on the A3, just going past the turning as Godalming comes in from the left.
Mm. I know.
And
we saw ahead of us a swan in the road. It was wet. It obviously landed there thinking it was the river. So I said to my husband, stop, stop, stop. We've got to, you know, do something. Oh, he thought, yeah, here we go again. So we stopped. And luckily, a lorry behind us stopped because he could see what was happening and blocked the road from any more traffic. And to cut a long story short, a couple of police cars arrived, and we managed to corral it and catch it and wrap it up in, whose coat? Mine, yes. Shove it in the boot of the car and take it to Hyde Stile, the, you know, the local wildlife hospital nearby, which is now, I think, not quite so open to the public as it used to be.
Mm-hmm.
But the one thing that really struck me was when the police officer who'd dealt with swans before managed to pick this animal up. He had it under his arm with his neck shoved under his arm, so the neck was facing backwards, and that really calmed the animal down. And as we were walking back to the to the car, I held on to one of its feet. Now, you look at them, you think they're black and wet and they'd be cold, but this was really, really warm. And of course, presumably, they get a lot of blood in their feet. Sorry, yes. For a bit of a frog. Oh. And it was an extraordinary experience.
And Very interesting.
It was. When we got to the...
Just as a matter of interest, I have been escorted by a police officer out of Craven Cottage in a similar way, and it is calming. Very calming.
What, with your head under his neck?
Very calming. He didn't take me to a vet. But anyway, carry on.
Dear, oh dear. But it was... But when we opened the boot, we thought it would have been, you know, flapping about, and it just put its head up, looked around as to say, well, where am I? And we were able to, you know, take it in, and they checked it over, and they told us later that it was uninjured, and, you know, let it go.
Well, good for you. Well done. I'm sure the swan doesn't give a hoot because they're arrogant what-sits, aren't they, to be honest?
Oh, I think they're beautiful birds. And I think possibly, I wonder if all the swans at that first lady was talking about near Arundel may not be wintering near the there's a wildfowl sanctuary there, isn't there, along by the river.
I would imagine. I
Wetlands
don't know.
And Wildfowl Trust, I think, have got a big we've never been there. We keep meaning to go there. You know what it's like. Must go down there one day. Mm. And we haven't quite reached there yet. But,
well, congratulations anyway. Job well done. And yeah. As I say, if the swan had it in them, him or her, I'm sure. Mind you, can you tell a difference? See, most ducks, you can tell apart, can't you? The male is beautiful. And the female, no offence. The female's rather dull and ordinary.
That's true. I think with swans, there's a difference with the knobble on the end of their beak. Where their beak joins their head, you've got, I don't know the proper term for it, you know, it's a knob or a bump, and it's either a different colour or a different shape.
Because I asked this question, and this is my contribution to the, it seems to me, never-ending argument about dangerous dogs.
Oh, God, yeah.
Right. Sadly, we still hear stories, awful stories, stories we don't want to dwell on.
Mm.
But maybe we should, because if pressure is put on the right people, then perhaps some kind of safeguards can finally be introduced.
I think it's tragedy for the dogs, because it's the way they're treated that makes them dangerous in the first place.
But is it always a dog?
Oh, I think there are certain breeds that have a particular allure for a particular type of person who will then take these dogs and... frankly, treat them brutally in order to turn them into brutes.
Now, what I'm saying is that I've covered stories like this. I can remember going back to 1976 when I was working in Fleet Street, and there was a glut.
Fleet Street, eh?
Well, yeah. Terrible glut of dog attacks.
Mm.
And I don't ever remember once having to write bitch.
Ha ha. Yeah, probably not.
And it's not something that anybody else has poured any kind of attention to on, so I just wonder whether that was journalistic laziness in not asking...
In calling it a dog as a
was it a dog or was it a bitch? I suspect that they were all dogs.
Quite likely.
And yet that's something that's not really thought through.
No.
And are they neutered?
Well,
dogs?
If they're neutered, they're less likely to become so aggressive.
Well, maybe that's the answer.
You keep them entire if you want them to be... aggressive, but I think even the so-called aggressive breeds like the Rottweilers, all those inverted commas guard dog type dogs, I think if they are inverted commas brought up in a normal family pet and treated as such, the chances are that they will probably be less I mean, they would be just like all any dog, just as unpredictable as any dog.
But, so you choose a dog, don't you, according to what you want the dog to give back to you? Now, well, we chose labs and retrievers because they're soppy, they're gentle.
Yeah,
and that
yeah
was
but my husband's defended a couple of those in court where they've bitten people and managed to get them off.
Mm.
So they're not all, you know, sweetness and light.
No,
any dog...
Hang on. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is we choose our dog according to what we hope they will give back to us.
Mm.
In choosing a dog that is known to have, under the right or the wrong circumstances or treatment, an aggressive side, one wonders whether a person, by choosing a dog that is believed to have that dimension, a person is declaring themselves as somebody who might be actually interested in promoting rather than curtailing that side of their personality.
Yep.
Thanks for your call, Angela. Nice talking to you. Well, Angela in Arford, who rescued a swan. They don't have a great reputation amongst those that know, do they, swans? After all, don't we say that somebody who is making a complete fool of themselves by acting way above their station, that they're swanning around? It's 20 past two. I've got a fine tune from Stevie Wonder, but Sylvia comes next. She's in Boxgrove. Hello, Sylvia.
Oh, hi, Tommy. I'm so interested in listening to everything on your programme. You're great. And I wanted to tell you, Tommy, I found out that Hanukkah seems to be derived from half naked. Because the Goodwood Estate records from 1540 are talking about the manor of Half Naked. And there was a huge house there in Hanukkah with an enormous wall all the way round. I don't know whether you know it.
This is dynamite, Sylvia.
Ah, yes, isn't it? I haven't read this book for ages, so I thought I'd look it up for you, you know?
Half Naked.
Half Naked, yes. And it seems to, over the years, sort of become Hanukkah.
Yeah.
And you can, well, yeah, if you look at the word...
Without the hard L, because the word half doesn't have a hard L, does it?
Exactly, because my grandfather used to maintain that this enormous wall was built by prisoners years ago. Oh, goodness, I'm not very good on history. But they were half naked, and he used to tell me that's why it was called Hanukkah.
Well...
That's a nice story.
That's got to go on the possible list.
Yes.
But I want to know who was half naked.
Yeah.
Whether they were half naked from the waist down or the waist up, which of course is critical.
That would be very
critical.
Yeah.
One suggests endeavour and perspiration, and the other is, you know, an arrestable offence.
Oh, they probably didn't have builder's bums in those days. So I don't think they were.
I bet you they did. It's an interesting concept.
Maybe.
Well, you've been... Yeah, that's five-star stuff, Sylvia.
Great.
Is that it? You haven't got anything else?
I want to suck you dry, dear. Sorry?
I want to suck you dry and everything you know.
Yeah, well, I've got the poem about Hanukkah Mill, which was written by Hilaire Belloc, who lived in Flinden.
Yeah.
And he lived there at the end of the 19th century. And then he went to Shipley, where he bought the windmill and lived in it there. You know Shipley near Horsham?
Yes.
But this poem was obviously written by him, you know, sort of nostalgic thing, I presume.
Is it long?
And he's written Hanukkah as H-A apostrophe N-A-C-K-E-R.
N-A-C-K-E-R.
Hanukkah. Hanukkah. So it's
Hanukkah. It does sound Hebrew to me.
Yeah.
Vaguely.
But there you go. He's called it Hanukkah Mill.
Okay, well, I'm really grateful for your call.
That's all right.
Love Boxgrove.
Yes, you like Boxgrove, don't you?
I do. There's a lovely pub now. What's it called again? That's
The Anglesey Arms.
That's the one.
Yep.
Yeah, that is the proper pub.
And that is actually in Hanukkah.
Is it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, right.
Yes, Hanukkah starts at the top of the street that runs through Boxgrove onto the road that goes from Chichester to Petworth.
I'm with you now. It's funny, this monk snatch thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
It sounds feeble, I think, if you don't give it a second thought. But then when you start to get into animals, and in the case of monk snatch, you know, just little places, all sorts comes up.
Yeah.
And, why do I love that Anglesey? Oh, because dogs are almost compulsory.
Yeah, they've got their own Labrador.
And he wanders in.
Retriever.
Yeah, he wanders in and out and in and out. It's great.
Yes.
Beautiful. Nice talking to you. Talk to you again.
Okay. Bye.
Nice lady. Sylvia in Boxgrove. So, the place that came out of the machine, the monk snatch machine today, we pronounced Hanukkah, but in fact it should be pronounced Hanukkah. And what Sylvia has got is that it may well have been originally half naked. Fantastic. If you can help, 08459 570057. I haven't plugged the text line, which is a good one if you're driving along. Do it safely. 07786 20 70 70 with anything. Or you can email, if you're at home or at work in front of your PC, tommy.boyd@bbc.co.uk. Here's that one from Stevie Wonder. Yeah. Stevie Wonder, and For Once in My Life. It's 27 minutes past two, the afternoon show on BBC Southern Counties Radio. There we were talking about Hanukkah, which is our place of the day that came out of the Monk Snatch machine at random. And there we were talking with Sylvia about the Anglesey, and we got Roger Jackson, who runs the place, on the line. Hello, Roger.
Hello, Tommy. How are you?
I've never been better. Never been better. Are you behind the bar at this moment?
I just popped up, actually, to do something in the office, and my wife sort of rushed up with the phone and said, you want to talk to you on the radio?
Yeah, but talking about Hanukkah, you see, which came out of the thing. What we found out, you can either confirm or go, I didn't know that, is it's actually not pronounced Halnukkah, of course, it's Hanukkah.
Hanukkah, yeah, no L at all in it. Yes, that's right.
Well, the lady who was on, who, by the way, loves your pub too, said that she thinks it used to be pronounced half-naked.
Well, there are several theories, yeah, as to how Hanukkah came about. I think that's by far the nicest theory.
Yeah.
There is another one which is very boring, which says it just might be half an acre.
Yeah.
Which you can see is possible, but not nearly as nice as the other story.
Now, how big is it then? Everyone knows where the Anglesey is, or should do.
Well, it's just that little sort of road where the Anglesey is on the 285, and then there's a little bit round the back of houses, but then we've got two enormous houses on the hill, which used to belong to the Goodwood Estate, as the pub does. And the ruins that the lady was on about before are still there, but a guy bought the house that was near there, knocked it down, and just built an enormous new one. And there's also the last house that Lutyens built on the hill here as well.
Really?
As well as the windmill, of course.
Thank you for that little history lesson there. And in return, you know, we, as I say, with Sylvia, we were chatting away about just what a nice traditional proper pub you have.
We do try and keep it as a very traditional pub. Yeah, I call it a pub and dining room on the sign outside, because we've still got the pub at the front, which is sort of, you know, floorboards and very basic
dogs.
Country pub. Sorry?
Dogs.
Dogs, yes. Harvey the half rug, yes. He's 12 in April and still wanders about the place. Head of security, I call him.
Yeah, yes. And we ought to be honest, because this is only the second time this has happened to me. Jenny, it was, decided to find somebody in Hanukkah and talk to them about the place. And because we do actually know each other, don't we?
We do, yes. I did tell Jenny that I'd met you in the Anglesey Arms and other places as well.
Well, I do remember you turning up for a Liverpool-themed fancy dress party, which is where I first bumped into you and your other half. Everybody had come dressed as one of the Beatles, except you two guys. Remember, it was a Liverpool-themed fancy dress party, Mersey and everything. And what did you come as?
The Liverpool Docks.
Nobody could work out who these two giggly couple were. They had white coats on and stethoscopes. And in the end, they said to me, go and ask them. You don't mind talking to idiots. So I said, how is this Liverpool? And they said, Mersey Docks. Bloody brilliant.
Different.
Love to your other half. Don't work too hard. I'll see you maybe in the pub or out on the golf course sometime.
Yeah, bring Richard along. Thanks.
Good lad.
See you.
Cheers,
bye.
Richard. Very, very nice man. And I'm not just saying that. 08459 570057. It's the afternoon show, BBC Southern Counties Radio. Monk Snatch place of the day is Hanukkah. Is it half naked or half an acre, as Roger said it might be? Lovely spot, isn't it, Hanukkah? We are lucky in this neck of the woods. Our beast of the day is the swan. We're not quite sure whether it's payback time for swans, because they've had it easy for a long, long time. And they are quite intimidating looking creatures, aren't they? But we'll spike that, put it all on hold. Got a fine tune for you after travel and weather. And then we're going to meet a new friend that we haven't met yet and have a chin wag.
BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel.
Not too bad at the moment. The traffic light's still out in Hastings on Carlisle Parade at White Rock Road. Henfield Road at Upper Beeding, yeah, that's all fine now. There was an accident, but traffic's returned to normal. Don't forget, the sewer works continue on Fishbourne Road West at Fishbourne itself, and Old Shoreham Road at Brighton, the A270 roadworks continue just by the cemetery. Public transport running well, but you can update us on 08459 570057. I'm Chris Lambert, BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel.
And the weather, it's not very good, I'm afraid. Maximum temperature today was 12 centigrade 54 Fahrenheit, which made it vaguely warm rain. Tonight, cloudy, exceptionally mild, little rain or drizzle at times. That minimum temperature is 11 centigrade 52 Fahrenheit overnight. First week in January, I don't know. Tuesday, cloudy, very mild. You got flowers coming out? We have. Feel for them, they're fools. It's their fault, they're not paying attention. Cloudy, very mild, with rain at times. The temperature tomorrow will go up to 14 degrees centigrade, which is very nearly 60 Fahrenheit. Outlook for Wednesday to Friday, rain slowly clearing later on Wednesday, becoming wet and very windy overnight. Colder Thursday, sunny spells, scattered showers, very windy, and yet more rain and strong winds to follow. On Friday, got an email, you'll like this. Paul emails, having read today that today is the most popular day to start divorce proceedings, can I just say that much as I love my missus, and this is one for the irritable hour, she irritates the bejesus out of me sometimes. Could you please play this one that I'm about to play and dedicate it to her for me?
Shadows of love on her blind. She was my woman. As she deceived me, I watched and went out of my mind.
So dedicating that, no doubt, with tongue entirely in cheek to Paul's wife there on this, the day when apparently more divorces take place than any other, not in any way suggesting that that's an alternative approach. 08459 570057. Now, it's a nice moment in the afternoon when we kick our shoes off and have a nice relaxed chat with a friend we haven't met yet. And today that's somebody with got a wonderful name, haven't you?
Thank you.
You say it.
All right then, Perdita.
Perdita is a beautiful name. Beautiful name. I know you've been asked this millions and millions of times, but I hope it's never boring. What's the derivation of Perdita?
Well, it depends what you read. It's okay. Either from Shakespeare, from A Winter's Tale, but it also happens to be one of the dogs in 1001 Dalmatians,
okay.
Commonly known as Perdita.
Okay.
But actually, I think the story is that my father was singing in a choir and met someone that he really fancied who was called Perdita. So there you go.
you're only the first person, you are the first person besides me who has that theory about how an awful lot of young girls get their names.
Yeah.
Because if I'd ever had a daughter, she was going to be called Alison, whether my wife liked it or not.
And she was someone you met that you really fancied.
Yeah, I couldn't help but fall in love with her when I was 17, because her father was the goalkeeper for Brentford.
Oh.
Aren't men fickle?
Yeah, well, I don't know much about Brentford. You'll have to tell me.
Absolutely. Now, Perdita, if I can just describe you very briefly for people who obviously wonder what you look like. You're fit.
Oh, thank you.
Aren't you?
That's very complimentary,
isn't it? How do you manage that?
I swim.
Yeah.
And I do yoga.
Yeah, I can tell.
Can you?
Oh, yeah.
So you do?
No, I don't. You can tell.
And now I've started running.
Have you?
Mm.
When did you start running?
I started in September, and okay. My husband is my trainer, which is absolutely excellent. And we did the 10-kilometer run for Chase from Loseley Park, which was great fun.
Do you know how Sherlock Holmes would have been able to tell that you're fit just from what you've been saying? Because you describe it as running, not jogging. There is a difference, isn't there?
Is there?
Well, you've got the proper shoes.
No, I haven't, actually.
Haven't you? Okay.
Rubbish shoes.
All right, I'm out on a limb now, but you do time yourself occasionally.
Yeah, my husband's got a watch.
Okay.
Mm.
He's fit, is he?
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he is.
Is that a sideline, or is that something he does, keeping himself in shape?
He does that all the time, really. But okay. He also is very human and enjoys pleasurable things as well, which are not so fit.
How long have you been together, the two of you?
25 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Family?
Have I got family? Yes, I got 3 children.
Okay.
Which is lovely.
How old are they now?
My daughter, who's 20, and she's just gone to university. Well, she's in her second year at university.
Where is she?
At Bristol. Okay. And went back yesterday. And my son, my elder son, he's at school in Cumbria. And he went back to school yesterday.
Oh.
Sedba, which is a wonderful school.
How does he get up there? Did he go up himself? Or was it around
thank goodness.
A car?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's 16 now, so he went by train. And he, it's a school where...
16 now.
16, exactly. Yes.
Shaving.
He's a serious man now. Mm. And this is a school where Will Carling went, and Simpson Daniel, and great rugby players, and he's a rugby player. And my other son is 13, and he's at school locally.
Okay.
Still on holiday.
All right. You say he's a rugby player. Whereabouts does he play on the pitch?
He's a winger.
Oh, he's quick?
He's quick.
Yeah.
Nifty.
What's your other half's name? You've mentioned him a couple of times, your husband.
He's called Gilles.
Gilles?
Yeah.
Okay. So who does he want to win the Six Nations?
He's very clear. Yes. It's France. He's very, very clear
about
that.
Where did you meet the two of you?
He's French.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I assumed. It doesn't have to be, but
doesn't
I assumed.
Doesn't have to be, no.
Where did you meet the two of you?
Cardiff.
Surely not at the Arms Park.
No.
No, thank goodness.
No. Oof. No, at the Sherman Theatre.
Okay.
Mm.
What were you doing there?
Well, that's where my life starts, really, in terms of my profession, because I was a theatre manager, and not at the Sherman, but I was working at Chapter Art Centre, and I decided I needed to go out and meet a few people, as well as all these crazy actors and artists.
Mm-hmm.
So I heard about this play, because French was my... specialty, and I went along because they were doing a play in French, and I went to the rehearsal, and there was this extremely handsome man who I thought was German, because I'd never seen a Breton before.
Where's Brittany again?
Brittany is it's the kind of bulge in France.
That's
and
right.
They
do look German then from that.
They're very strong. I'd been to Paris.
They've got jaws.
Yeah.
They've got proper jaws.
Yes.
A lot of Frenchmen haven't, have they?
Exactly.
Well, Parisians all look like Danny Baker to me. What's the matter with them? They don't look after themselves at all.
Well, the ones I'd seen had all been very kind of petite and, you know, very kind of aquiline features. And here was this very burly person. And
what was he doing?
He was an assistant in a school teaching French.
Okay.
It went from there.
Okay, it went from there. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Do you remember clapping eyes on this man, handsome enough to be German?
Oh, yeah.
But turned out to have the best accent of all?
Yeah, I saw him from behind.
Well, I suppose, yeah. Okay, it's a bit fruity for first thing in the afternoon, but we're only human, aren't we?
And he had a very nice red scarf, too.
Did you romance in French or English?
French.
Of course.
French.
Of course.
Which is the language for love.
It is, isn't it?
Mm.
What was this French play? Do you remember that you went along to see?
No, this was to be in it. And he was the main part, and it was called Au Printemps des Bonnets Rouges, which is all about the revolutionaries in Brittany.
Okay.
And I then discovered, in fact, I wasn't going to be there for the final performances because I was going off to Greece. So I met my future husband, went off, he took the main lead, but fortunately it carried on beyond the play.
Did you write whilst you were in Greece? Or did you just hope he'd still be there for you when you
got
back? Yeah,
I did, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. How confident were you? What age were you, if I can ask?
How old was I? Oh, it's a long, long time ago. So I was about 25, okay. 26.
Okay. Mm. Well, we know more about people at 25 and 26 than we did when we were 18 and 19, don't
you
think?
Yes, yes, yes.
So your judgment was that Gilles would probably...
Oh, I was...
Still be there?
Yeah.
He was living and working in Cardiff?
Yes.
Okay. And where are you from, if I may ask?
I was born in South Africa.
You strike me as being somebody who is just a child of the world.
Oh, Tommy, what about you?
Me? I'm sort of, but not probably nowhere near as a sort of a United Nations person as you. My family is sort of Scottish Glasgow, then via Newcastle, and then London, and now I'm down on the south. We're slipping... gradually southwards. I think if I have grandchildren, they'll probably be born, well, probably in Brittany.
Exactly.
The way we're slipping down in that direction, yeah. So you're born in South Africa.
Yes.
Which wasn't the country it is now.
No. It's a beautiful, beautiful country. And my father was in the Foreign Office, so I travelled a lot as a child. And my parents happened to be there, so I left when I was 18 months old, but they did allow me to go back there when I was 19, and I travelled everywhere by train, which is an amazing experience in South Africa. They go very slowly, and you see a lot.
God, yes.
So that was great. And it gave me... Well, it gives you pictures in your mind. And when I was lucky enough to work, as I did before my current job at WWF, World Wildlife Fund, I went back to some of the places I'd been as a child, and... realized that some of the things I'd seen as a child were now seriously at risk or even disappeared.
Mm.
And that's an extraordinary privilege, but also very frightening and worrying too.
So when did you move out of the arts and into WWF?
Well, it was a kind of detour into the environment because my training was arts management. And
where did you study?
I studied at Sussex University, and then I did City University in London. I did a diploma in arts management. And during that, I did a placement in Cardiff, which is why I went back there to work there for a bit. And I also went to California, which was wonderful. And I did jobs as well as Cardiff. I then did a wonderful nearly 8 years in Suffolk at the Aldborough Festival, which was founded by Benjamin Britten and Peter Pears, and is one of the most exciting places and wonderful concert hall. And I moved from there to the Arts Council, and then I went to the Heritage Lottery Fund. And at the lottery fund, I was giving projects to environmental projects, to, you know, institutions, finding out a bit about saving the forests and butterflies and coastline. And I thought, I ought to do something about this because my children are going to grow up in a world where they really don't see the things or enjoy the things that I did. Also, I was living in Godalming, and WWF is in Godalming, and I got this wonderful job at WWF. But all the time, my heart was really with the arts.
Mm.
And I'd actually been to this gallery, and with a friend who I met when I did my arts management training, and she lived in Godalming, and she said, you should come and see this place. And I'll always remember the day. It was sort of about 5 o'clock on a long summer afternoon. The shadows were lengthening, and we went to this cemetery, which was on a hill looking out, and this extraordinary round red brick chapel. And you go in it, and suddenly you see these incredible coloured angels, they look like, figures. And she said, yeah, this is the Watts Chapel. And then we walked up the road and discovered the Watts Gallery. And I couldn't believe in the middle of this Surrey landscape was this extraordinary place with a collection of international importance by an artist I'd never heard of before. So that always lingered in my mind, and I'm lucky enough now, Tommy, to work there and Fantastic. Be the director.
Fantastic. Somebody up there likes you. And I'm sure you've earned every favour you get, but you're having a good time, aren't you?
Oh, I'm loving it. Yeah. When you get a job that suddenly brings together a lot of the things that you've learned or experienced or you feel passionate about, then you are very lucky. And it is a very important place, so I feel very privileged.
What's your philosophy? Do you believe that we have this one life, or do you believe that there might be something else, or are you certain that there's something else and you've got a clear idea of what it might be, or do you not like to talk about that sort of thing too much on a Tuesday afternoon?
No, I'm happy to, actually. I am a Christian, and my faith is important to me, and I do believe that there is an afterlife, and I do believe in a number of things that the Bible tells us. So I again find it interesting that I'm with a collection and an artist and a visionary who is dealing with a lot of the themes of life, whether it's love, progress, or envy, or greed. He deals a lot with greed, does Watts. He tackles some of the difficult subjects, and he takes a lot of the stories from the Bible. So he himself, George Frederick Watts, didn't fall into any particular religious group, but yet knew that there were a number of issues that needed looking at.
And Gilles, you meet this poor man.
Poor man.
He doesn't realise he's getting onto a roller coaster, did he? Or maybe he did. Maybe that's what he liked about you best of all.
Yeah.
And he's been to Suffolk with you?
Yeah, I felt he was on a journey, and that's life's about that, isn't it?
Yes.
You meet your travelling companion, and you jump on something that floats, and you follow the river, really.
Absolutely.
And we did it together, and he got his first job in a school in Suffolk, which is why I went there. And he's taken up as a teacher, and he's, I think, a wonderful teacher. He's really made a difference to a number of people's lives, I think.
That's what it's all about.
But he also is a very good Frenchman, so he can teach quite a bit of French. But fives is his sport. Heard of
I think
fives.
I have, yes. I wouldn't know how to line up for a game of fives.
No, you'd need four.
I believe
of
it's
you.
Pretty gruesome.
That's hard work, yeah, and you have to play with both hands too.
Yes. And just whilst we're being totally nosy, your daughter is doing what at Bristol?
Well, funnily enough, she's doing French studies.
Okay.
And she's bilingual, and she is enjoying it, and will spend a year in France.
Okay.
And her theatre is her great thing. So, like her mother and her father, who met in theatre, she's loving acting. But
is she enjoying being at uni?
Very much. She's deriving everything she wants out of it.
Wasn't sure the first term.
Yeah, a bit of that, yeah.
Okay.
Yes, but it's the first term when you were in hall.
How did you find the first term at uni, at Sussex?
I didn't enjoy it.
Where were your folks then?
They were overseas. They were in West Indies.
So you arrived at Falmer alone?
You know it. Have you been there?
I was at Falmer.
Were you?
What year were you there? This could be spooky. Let's hope not, because it could get complicated.
This is a real giveaway.
Well, we'll do it afterwards. That was me at the end of the hitching queue.
I was, the hitching queue, I remember.
Yes, okay.
But I was also talking to my children about this crazy restaurant that was there called the Macrobiotic Restaurant. Do you remember that?
Yeah, early lentils.
Early lentils.
Very early lentils. Bit
That's
filling.
That's the one.
Then. Soya had not come into its own.
And I said all the food was brown.
Yeah, well, very brown.
Very
filling.
And very filling, yeah. To the Macrobiotic Restaurant.
As the man said, it's a small world, but you wouldn't want to have to paint it.
No, you would not.
So what's your day-to-day then with dividing your time? Are you between WWF and Watts?
No, I then left WWF to go to Watts because my heart drew me back. Well, actually, my belief is that Mary Watts drew me back because Mary Watts, the second wife of George Frederick Watts, his first wife was Ellen Terry, who's a great actress.
Yeah.
And she very much helped him in the latter part of his life and kind of set up the pottery. She built the chapel, the cemetery chapel that I described, and she supported her husband and then founded the Watts Gallery in 1904. And she, you feel her presence still.
With such an appreciation of the arts, are you tempted yourself to paint, to write, to perform?
I paint. The greatest joy for me is when I sit alongside my daughter and we both do a watercolour of the same site, and then I take that home and frame it, and it's a wonderful way of remembering a special place, a special time. And I play the piano and the flute, and I actually had to be called along recently to help out with a lovely service at Littleton Church, which is in Loseley Park, playing the organ for their Christmas service, animal service, where they bring in the donkey and the sheep, which was a very great privilege, which I really enjoyed. So yeah, I play instruments and I love singing. So I join my son occasionally in his choir at school and sing.
Which one?
The youngest. He's a great singer.
And of course he's learnt so much because now he's got you to himself.
Oh, yes.
And this has been a real coming of something or other, I would imagine. It would be for most youngsters. It's to go from being the youngest, and therefore kind of the baby, now to being like the third adult in the house. It's quite a sea change for him.
He's just terribly rude to me, actually. we love each other, but he likes his mother being able to do everything for him. But it's a great joy to have him there. And he's suddenly shot up, and he's now nearly taller than me. He plays rugby too at the Guildford Rugby Club.
Yeah, you're going to have two big boys, aren't you?
Yeah. So you don't mess about. He now keeps picking me up, which doesn't make my authority very strong.
Well, it's when he starts picking Gilles up, you'll know.
Yeah, they haven't got there yet.
Yeah, well, they will. They will.
More frightened in the
fights. The old test of strength. Don't you worry. That'll happen. The old mock fights in the hall between dad and son.
Yeah.
Just I often used to say to my sons when I gave them a piggyback upstairs to bed, I said, don't you worry, it'll be your turn to piggyback me up to bed before long. We'll flash by.
I know. There's a tipping point, isn't
yes.
it? It suddenly happens.
And for you, of course, having children means that whatever aims and ambitions and hopes for the future you have, they're kind of put to one side. You still have them, but they're channeled, aren't they, so much through your children and your hopes for them.
Yes, they are.
And their happiness.
I agree with you. It's interesting to have been a working mother, which I have been all the way through, and I think now that opportunity as a mother, which of course your first concern is your children, is now recognised far more in the workplace. I noticed outside you had both a dog and a child in here, which is really nice. So congratulations on BBC Southern Counties on a very equal opportunity.
They're in the majority, actually, you may have noticed. They're thin on the ground at the moment. The dog, a child, and Mark Carter. And Jenny Day, of course.
Yes.
Quite rightly. Well, I'm in the newsroom, Jenny Day. Don't get iffy.
And I think that's life. Life is not about compartments, watertight compartments.
Yes.
Life, everything kind of links into everything else. And if the employer and the workplace can understand that, you'll get people who are far more dedicated to working or far more dedicated to parenting because their employer understands it, or vice versa. And I'm so pleased to see that that's become far more fluid than it was at the beginning when I had my children.
Ever so slowly, inch by inch, although a lot of people like to say this isn't the case, but I believe that ever so slowly, inch by inch, the world just becomes a little bit better bit by bit. And, you know, who knows, maybe heaven will be on earth, but it might not be for 100 or maybe even 1,000 years. But as long as there are people with good heart and endeavour like yourself,
well,
keep up the good work.
Thank you.
And is this, you mentioned your work at the, not museum, but
Gallery.
Yeah, gallery.
Watts Gallery,
okay,
yeah.
And that is open to the unwashed like me, is it?
Oh, it's open to everyone. It's about art for all. We're looking for support. We're looking for people to join us as friends or as volunteers. And above all, please come to visit us. And if you did vote for us for BBC Restoration, thank you for that as well.
Nice one. Wonderful to meet you.
Thank you.
Possibly again, who knows?
Thank you, Tommy.
Just have a little patience. Still hurting from a love I lost. I'm feeling your frustration.
Manchester,
Lewes,
Eastbourne,
Petworth,
Hove, the sound of Sussex. BBC Southern Counties Radio.
281 at Henfield, that's Brighton Road, because of tree cutting just near to the High Street until about 4:30 today. And it's going to be ongoing for the next few days. The 801 actually closed for that tree cutting. Tilford Road at Farnham, still the gas main work continues near to the junction with Alfred Road. You can update us on 08459 570057. I'm Chris Lambert, BBC Southern Counties Radio Travel.
This afternoon will remain damp and grey with the winds picking up, so a wet and blustery spell of weather ahead. Despite the gusty conditions, it's mild for the time of year with highs of 12 Celsius, that's 54 Fahrenheit, with pearly, punchy, southerly and southwesterly winds drawing in mild air. Tonight's going to be exceptionally mild and could be record-breaking, with overnight lows of 11 Celsius, the cloud cover keeping temperatures up. A second band of cloud moves across from the west, bringing rain and drizzle on and off throughout the night, with strong southwesterly winds developing and gusting up to 45 miles per hour. The strong wind should ease tomorrow, but another cloudy and mild day is in store with further rain at times. Highs tomorrow will be even milder than today at 13 Celsius, that's 55 Fahrenheit, so a good 6 degrees above the seasonal average. The rain will slowly clear by Wednesday, but then it's going to become very wet once again and windy. Thursday looks to be colder with some sunny spells, but the strong winds will remain a constant theme this week. BBC Southern Counties Radio Weather, I'm Georgie Palmer.
The sound of Sussex. BBC Southern Counties Radio.
Although, just for the record, the sound of BBC Southern Counties Radio for the next 55 minutes or so is going to be rather acidic because it's the Irritable Hour. Welcome to the Irritable Hour. What makes you irritable? What's been making you irritable over the last 24 hours, or maybe two or three days, or maybe since New Year's or Christmas? 08459 570057. I have to motor, you have to motor, everyone motors sometime, even if they're sitting in the passenger seat or up front in the double decker. And you know what makes me irritable is those double parkers, and there's usually one in Hazelmere, if you want to be specific, those double parkers who drive her to the shops and then let her out so that she can nip in, except it's always 10 minutes, and they just sit there double parked. They sit there double parked, sometimes with their emergency lights flashing. What's happening is they are double parked. They know that they're not going to get a ticket, because if a traffic warden comes along, then obviously they can go round the block a couple of times, which is probably what they ought to be doing anyway, regardless of the damage done to the environment. Because the damage that's being done whilst they're sitting there double parked is that the traffic is backed up all the way past the War Memorial, inevitably. And pubs make me irritable, because pubs no longer are pubs. Pubs are restaurants, pubs are cafeterias. It's no surprise to a beer drinker like myself that Happy Chef or the Little Chef, whatever it's called, is going under, because nowadays it's pubs that sell all the hamburgers and the breaded cod and chips. Breaded cod and chips? Who wants breaded cod and chips? It's battered cod and chips. But the sign outside, it's always the sign outside that annoys me, the black chalk board that boasts all-day teas and coffees. You're a pub. That boasts fresh local food. You're a pub. Fresh caught local... you're a pub! Tonight, live music with Willie O'Mitt. You're a pub! You're a pub. I want a chalkboard sign. Is there a chalkboard sign outside a pub anywhere in the Western world that says, we sell beer? 08459 570057. Loads of it within. Yellow stuff and brown stuff. Some of it's English, some of it's German. Are you feeling irritable? I tell you what, this is great therapy. 08459 570057. Or you can text 07786 2070 70, but don't do it while you're going along. That makes lots of people irritable. Or you can email tommy.boyd@bbc.co.uk. You go to a pub, you're probably healthier skipping the food and having four pints, as long as you don't drive home. And why are all cab firms called Streamline? There's nothing streamlined about their driving. There's nothing streamlined about their waistlines, to be brutal. So which bit's streamlined then? And football commentators. I've got an email from Ed Walker, who says on sport. He says, I find many things about organised sport intensely irritating. Thanks for your email, Ed. These two especially so. Firstly, the puerile, facile nickname that always ends in "-ers," that anyone associated with cricket, players or commentators is automatically assigned, hence aggers and toughers. Do they all imagine that they are characters in some 1930s boy's own story? Grow up, says Ed. And the ritual spraying of champagne that occurs after every single Grand Prix race, why? And why do the participants always look so surprised and giddy when it happens? Absolutely. It happens every time, he says. Can't read that word. Do something vaguely original with the champagne, boys, for goodness sake, like drink it, for example. Fantastic. And commentators saying words like entering the fray when all that's happening is that a substitute entering the fray. A sub's coming on. Or atoning for his earlier error. No, he's just kind of fixed it a little bit because he scored a naff own goal and now he's scored one down. Atoning for the error. And this one. Older people's wire baskets in the supermarket. Do they still think that there's rationing? All that sugar and cream and biscuits and tapioca and wine. We were up at Wittering. We'd walked the dog. We were sitting in the car having a cup of soup when they've got recycled bins up at Wittering. I don't know why, but there was crash. You know, the noise of bottles going into the bottle bag and crash and crash and crash. I'm not exaggerating. This went on for 5 minutes. And in the end, I couldn't resist swinging round and having a look to see who was getting through so much wine this Christmas, 80 bottles of it, and it was a little old lady. She was about 78. I mean, good for her up to a point. But what about the healthy eating thing? Are you only supposed to eat healthy when you're young and healthy? Surely when you're a little bit older, it makes more sense to eat a little bit more carefully and not get through so much sherry. 08459570057. And cookery books. Wild pigeon with ricotta compote. Huh? Deep-fried gnocchi on a bed of crushed peas. Boned roast spring fowl with wilted kohlrabi and pak choy. I have one word that sums that lot up. After! As I believe they prefer the roundhouse kick. That is funny. Thank you for that. And Mark in Chichester wants to know why our so-called weather experts... what happened to their promise of dry, bright and warm weather? Thank you for that, Mark. 08459 570057. And Irritable Anne says, is there such a thing as irritability? Yes, definitely. I think most women will agree that once a month, to a lesser or greater degree, they are indeed irritable. I think irritability is more of a woman thing. Men seem to get grumpy and or rather angry rather than irritable. I'm not knocking the male of the species when I say that. It's just an observation. 08459 570057. Wayne's on the line from Enfield. Hello, Wayne.
Hello. Yeah, no, I know I'm normally a wonderful hour caller, but I found myself with an irritation, Tommy.
Go on then.
Yeah. Yes, you know, I drive about 1,200 miles a week, yeah. And not much gets to me. People can pull out in front of me, reverse off their driveways, yeah. Cut me up. Nothing gets to me, but found myself in a strange situation yesterday, driving through a town in Hertfordshire, 30 mile an hour speed limit, and I stick to the speed limits now pretty rigidly. Because you just never know where the police are hiding with their speed guns, so you've just got to now, because a licence is too important. Absolutely. And drove through this town called Potter's Bar, not a very big town, and I got to a set of traffic lights where just the town ended and we were going to go out into the country, a set of filter lights, and I pulled up, and I looked in my mirror, and I saw somebody walking along the side of my vehicle. I thought, oh, maybe I've got a light out or something. So I opened the window. I thought, I haven't done anything wrong. So he couldn't have pulled out in front of him, opened the window. He said, I'd like to question you about your driving. I thought, oh, we've got a plainclothes policeman here. He said, you're driving rather cautiously through this town. And I said, yeah, well, I'm driving dead on the speed limit, according to my speedo. He said, well, I've seen you before in this town, and you're driving far too cautiously. And I said, well... I don't know what to say. I said, maybe my speedo's out. I said, but I've got a tracking device which I can double-check against. And he said, and then I heard the words. I thought, well, soon I'm going to have to be breathalyzed, or he's going to want to search the vehicle. There's got to be a reason for this. This can't be the reason. And suddenly I heard the words about route and my passengers are being held up. And I looked in my mirror and I thought, there's a red bus behind me. I said, you're not the bus driver, are you? He said, yeah, that's right. I said, what are you doing leaving your bus unattended in the middle of the road? I said, to come along here and ask me why I'm... I said, we've only just passed a memorial tribute, of floral tribute to a... looks like a young boy that's been mowed down in this town. And he said, but you're holding my route up, and I've been behind you before. And I thought... I said, well, just go back to your bus. And you know when you think afterwards what you should have said?
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm thinking, I just don't believe this.
That is unbelievable. That is shocking.
I've never been in that situation before. I was doing dead on the speed limit and, like, you know, absolutely dead on the button because I can double check it.
Of course
and
you can.
I thought, I just don't believe that happened. That he could have.
See, that's one for the gobsmacked hour, really, if there were such a thing.
But I thought it was I'd be in shock. I thought he was a plainclothes policeman, and there was going to be an... Obviously, that was the reason to, like, come along and approach me and say, can you pull over? I'd just like to breathalyse you.
Yeah.
And, you know, they've been told to go out and, like, pull up a few drivers.
Yeah.
And,
This is what this is what tailgating is all about. They want to do 53, and you're doing 48, and so they'll get up your jacksy because they want you to go faster. They don't want to take the risk of overtaking you, you know, but they do want you to go faster, so they'll...
But it's like something like out of the Wild West, isn't it? It's like something like, you know, you're in my town.
Yeah.
Cautiously.
When you're in Potter's Bar, you drive like the Potter's Barians. Stupidly.
Yeah, that's right.
Nice one, Wayne, thank you.
All right. Fairly.
God, that's beyond irritating, isn't it? That is enough to make you really want to do something antisocial, I think. Well done, Wayne. 0845957057. Nikki's on the line from Farnham. Hello, Nikki.
Hiya, Tommy.
Are you irritable?
Yes, I'm actually very livid. I went to hospital today to get my son's leg plastered because he broke it on Saturday night. And he's disabled and I'm disabled. And when I saw the specialist and everything and he had it plastered and all that crap, which takes hours and hours and hours. Our appointment was 10:30. We got out there at 1:00, which annoys me intensely anyway. But I said, can you lend me a wheelchair? Because I can't get him into the house unless I have a wheelchair. He can't use crutches. He's not physically able to use crutches. And they said no.
No?
They said no. And I said, that's ridiculous. There must be a wheelchair somewhere in this hospital.
Wheelchair in a hospital?
Me.
Are you mad?
Well, precisely.
Surely
and
not.
One of the nurses ran the occupational therapy department, and they said, no, we only lend wheelchairs to inpatients, not outpatients. So if he was staying in the hospital, they would lend him a wheelchair, but not if he's coming out. And they said that if I couldn't get him home, then the only alternative was to admit him. And I said, well, surely the cost of a wheelchair is far less than admitting my son for 8 weeks, which is how long he's got to be in plaster. And they said, yeah, but we can't lend you a wheelchair.
Person with a broken leg can't have a wheelchair?
No. And he's in plaster right up to the top of his thigh.
Makes he's beyond...
Not a half cast.
Being irritated is that what you can do is mentally plot the kind of revenge that you would take but never will. You know, but it's hard to plot that against a hospital because...
Well, I'm going to write to the chief executive because I think it's just ludicrous.
Yeah.
And what made it even worse is the fracture clinic door has a button on it saying press here to open it, and the flipping thing didn't work. And it's been like that for months, apparently. So anybody on crutches or in a wheelchair cannot get in the door.
Well, thanks for your contribution to the Irritable Hour. I hope your boy's leg mends all right.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Bye.
That's Nikki in Farnham. She's holding on to her irritability, I thought, there, being quite placid about it. You know, I find myself a little bit like that. I'll tell you about one thing that does really irritate me, good listener. Listen to this. You will find that this irritates you as well. One thing that irritates me, in fact, the only thing that irritates me about young people, right, is that nothing irritates them. Nothing. Not earphones, not people listening to their Sony Walkman and going, not people on their mobile phones, they're not bothered. People riding their bicycles never irritates a young person. On the pavement or going through red lights, they're not bothered. You get cold calls from double glazing companies. Sometimes my son picked the phone up. They're amused. All right? Junk mail comes through. I say to them, could you get the mail? They say, oh, it's just their dad. They're not bothered. They don't want to ring a radio program or write to their MP or the senior registrar or anything. You get bits dropping out of the newspapers. I say to them, see if you can find me something to win the 3:30 at NAS. My son will open it up and a load of stuff will drop out and he just goes, oh. Doesn't get irritated. Young people don't get buses come late, buses come early. They just don't let it get to them. I mean, I would love it if one of these days my son said to me, oh, God, Dad, I'll tell you, it drives me up the wall. But they're not. They are so laconic. 08459 570057. Joy's called from Burgess Hill to say that she is irritated by men who don't shave. And Pam emails tommy.boyd@bbc.co.uk. Happy New Year, she says. At least it was for me until I read an advertisement in the Sunday Mail and now I'm very irritable. Apparently, if you have debts of more than £15,000, there is now government legislation to clear your debts at very little cost to the debtor. Creditors can happily and legally write off up to 77% of a person's debts. Perhaps irritable is not a strong enough word for how I feel. What about all us folks who manage their finances well and stay out of debt? Help like the above just encourages people to spend what they haven't got. What happened to self-discipline? Your weight listeners is very good, says Pam. This is something that we're running a bit like Weight Watchers, but not, whereby all you have to do is make a mental note of everything you've eaten in the last 24 hours. And you see how many handfuls of this and that, or just the odd biscuit, you really didn't need. She says, your weightlessness is very good and has kept my fingers out of the biscuit stroke chocolate tin. Keep it going. Thanks very much indeed for that, Pam. Reminder, the number is 08459 570057. It's the Irritable Hour on the afternoon show on BBC Southern Counties Radio.
Tonight, my world of radio heads to Turkey. Roger and out, new competition is back. Three prizes tonight, because nobody's got it right so far. The featured music year is 1968. And heart on your sleeve.
Wear your heart on your sleeve. Gallagher and Lyle, and Heart on Your Sleeve. I've got this email from Diane. Di. Who says, yes, there is such a thing as irritability. It's Irritable Hour on BBC Southern Counties Radio, usually on a Monday from 3 until 4. We just trade in the kind of things that get up one's nose, because a lot of people feel irritable on a Monday. She says, I am irritable with the internet this afternoon, which seems incredibly slow. It is slowing down, isn't it? Isn't the internet slowing down? What next? We're going to be told now that there's a new invention. It's better than broadband. If you're finding broadband slow at £29.99 a month, then you can get Megaband for £49.99. Yeah. Anyway, I'm being cynical. She says, I am using the jars of vitamins, which I have. Should be fresh, not worth hoarding. I went to a private school and hated it. I think a technical school would have suited me better, but children didn't voice their opinions in those days. No, shame. Unlike today, she says, I vowed I would never send a child to one, had no children, so the question didn't arise. Swans, she agrees, can be very scary, and she threatens to listen in to the Irritable Hour as if she was a listener and not just somebody I email. How are you, Jenny Day? Are you irritable at all?
I am very irritable. Can I tell you why? It's my remote control on my telly. Mm. I stupidly bought a telly because it looked attractive, you see. A silvery one, rather flat screen. And it was also cheap. It looked a lot dearer than it actually was. What I didn't realise, I didn't care at the time, it had no buttons on it. It's got no buttons. So you have to use your remote control. Well, the remote control's now pooped. Yeah. It won't work. The springs have fallen out. The battery's fallen out. So we're very deprived on one telly for four of us. And as there are three reality TV shows that we all want to watch, husband wants to watch the football, we're all very, very cross with each other.
Who does he support again?
He supports Derby County. They're hardly ever on because they're so quite dull, aren't they? Mm. And he supports anyone who is playing Manchester United.
Okay.
And a deep admiration, really, for Arsene Wenger, I think.
Well, I was going to say, I'll tell you who's irritating, and that's Arsene Wenger.
Oh, he's so irritating.
He looks like an Afghan hound.
He's a very aloof, isn't he?
He is.
He needs to relax. He needs to booze and eat chocolate and do naughty things, I think.
We'll move on swiftly from that notion of Arsene Wenger doing any naughty things. Arsene Wenger always buys these very irritating, boring, foreign sort of wingettes. They're not wingers and they're not midfield players. They're all 5'8". They all weigh 10.5 stone. They're all quite quick. They all can dribble a little bit, but they're extremely sensible men apart from their haircuts. And they're all called things like Freddie Lundberg. And now he's got a couple called Rizitsky and Hleb. And there's nothing of them. They wouldn't get into Brentford's first team, but somehow he manages. It all started with Mark Overmars. I blame him. I'm going on a little bit.
Didn't he get rid of Mark Overmars? Who's the one who was grumpy and he got rid of him?
All of them. They only have 3 years with him and then he gets rid
yes,
of them.
That's
three
it.
3 years and they're gone.
Because he's consistently doing
back
the same
France.
Thing and then he hasn't learnt from his mistake. He needs to find a Ryan Giggs.
08459570057. It's the Irritable Hour on BBC Southern Counties Radio.
Tommy Boyd on BBC Southern Counties Radio.
Virginia has texted, and I think this might be a private message. I can't remember us touching on a Sean on the programme this afternoon. Virginia says, shot in the dark, but if you could, please tell Sean to keep his chin up, as he is a very brave and lovely man. Okay, thank you very much indeed for that. And David says, I think you're irritable. Yes, of course I'm irritable, David. Well done. He says, swans are nice birds, not at all terrifying. And why are you so gullible as to buy all these things you don't want or need and then complain about it? You're absolutely right, David. If there's anything that makes me really irritable, it's me. And Mark in Uckfield has emailed. We were talking, had that caller then, Wayne, earlier on, who said that he had a bus driver get out of his bus, pull up behind him at the traffic lights, get out of his bus and approach him and tell him that he was driving too cautiously through Potter's Bar. And so Mark emails, that last chap, Wayne, reminded me of the times when I get overtaken in a 30 or a 40 limit, only to be held up by that same person doing 45 in a 60 limit. And that makes me really irritable. Good show, Tommy. Thank you very much indeed for that, Mark. Here's Kate Bush. She is excellent. Fine song, fine singer, but slightly irritating. I don't know why this is. Just a little bit. Just a little bit irritating. It's her lipstick. Kate Bush. Running up that hill, that's nearly 20 to 4. In the irritable hour on BBC Southern Counties Radio, where we say to people listening to the programme, such as you at home or driving along, or halfway home from the school run, maybe, I don't know, what makes you irritable? Lauren is on the line from Heathfield. Hello, Lauren.
Hi, Tommy.
You feeling a bit irritable?
Yes, I am.
Tell me about it.
I play the saxophone, obviously, and get annoyed when my next-door neighbour comes and tells me to be quiet.
You look to the world?
Yeah.
It is hard, because, I mean, what can you do? You can't put a sock in it, can you?
No.
When I lived in a village, where are you? Heathfield?
Yeah.
We'd been there about 6 weeks, and I heard bagpipes, honestly. Yeah. And what it was a man who wanted to learn to play the bagpipes was being made by his wife and his neighbours to go and stand in the middle of a cow field to practice his bagpipes. I think people should play musical instruments. It should be compulsory, and you're playing the most beautiful instrument of them all.
Yeah.
Do you happen to have it to hand?
I'm in the car, so.
Okay, no sweat. What else makes you irritable then?
Nothing really.
No?
When Mum shouts at me for not doing anything.
When really, you know, it's her fault, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. All right.
I also go to a boarding school.
I see. Does that make you irritable, or are you happy there?
Sometimes it makes me irritable.
I can imagine, yes.
Because
you haven't really got anywhere of your own, have you?
No.
No. And everyone needs a bit of territory to go away and...
Yeah.
You know, punch the pillow.
Yeah.
Yeah. What sort of sax music do you like playing, Lauren?
Well, I've only just started, so I'm not really doing very much.
Why did you start? Was it Lisa Simpson?
No, my mum works for a saxophone company.
Okay. And free and saxophones.
Pardon?
Free saxophones.
No.
No.
I went in to work with her one day and they sounded really nice. So
great. What sort of a sax have you got?
It's an alto.
Alto. Beautiful.
Yeah.
What sort of sax music do you like that you've heard? Can you think of any other saxophonists whose work you like?
No, not really.
No, well, there was a great guy called Raph Ravenscroft, is one name that springs to mind. I expect you can get examples of good sax on the internet, can't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so.
Well, you keep up the sax and just ignore them.
Okay.
Yeah, cheers.
Cheers.
There's Lauren from Heathfield. She plays the sax. They play football right until 10 o'clock at night, her next-door neighbours, but as soon as she starts practising her sax, they come round and ask her to turn it down, which you can't. Irritating. Thank you for that, Lauren. This from CJ Olson, who is listening to the show in Port Townsend, Washington State, USA, says, I'll tell you what raises my hackles. Other drivers who put on a mad dash of speed to get in front of your vehicle at a junction, and then once comfortably in front of you, slow down to a rate of speed 5 miles slower than the posted limit. Always, of course, in a nice long stretch of motorway where you can't overtake them. Not to mention the all-pervading American habit enshrined in law of driving on the wrong side of the road. That's another reason I overtake as often as I can, for a few seconds at least. I have an excuse to travel on the side of the road favoured by proper civilised people. Yours with a spray of gravel and a muttered oath. Thank you for that, CJ. David's on the line from Worthing. Hello, David.
Hello, Tommy. How are you?
I'm really well. I'm a bit irritated, but anyway.
Right.
You were listening to the programme?
I was, in connection with Jenny's problem with her remote control.
Go on.
Just saying that we might be able to help her out and fix it for her, if we could sort of somehow arrange to get it from her.
I see. You want her to... Well, if she sends you the remote...
Yes.
Well, let me get her in. Because these remotes can be boogers, can't they?
They can, but we got... I've got a tester.
Hello.
Hello.
You're so kind. What do you want me to do? It's a grinding TV. The TV's fine. It's just... It doesn't match the... You know, the remote control's conked.
Right. Well, all we need to do is... I've got an electronics workshop in Worthing, West Sussex. If we can somehow get the remote from you, so we can have a look at it, and chances are we can repair it for you.
Oh, I have to tell you, a spring has flopped out, and I can't find it. It's probably in one of the cracks of the sofas. There's a spring, isn't there?
Don't go into the
remote. There is a spring. Well, the back's already fallen off. The little cover for where the battery is.
The cover is meant to break. so that you have to put some elastoplast over the battery. That's
some
a design
insulation tape, Tommy.
Feature or insulation tape.
Insulation tape,
Tommy. That's a crude way. Yeah.
Or gaffer tape. I've never known why it's called gaffer tape, but anyway.
Or masking tape.
Yes.
I know that goes a bit mucky.
It does.
I shall do that. Yes, it does. It's really irritating.
Although you can buy this new masking tape now that evidently doesn't leave a residue, but I haven't actually had any dealings with that.
I have. It's that blue stuff, and that leaves a residue too.
Right.
That's very irritating.
It's extremely
irritating. Christmas and New Year was irritating for me. I got really on my high horse, but that was last week, but I didn't manage to phone in last week.
Well, you're probably still finding it irritating.
Oh, I am, very much.
Go on then, what happened?
Well, I just got. It just goes on for too long, doesn't it?
No,
people are all cheerful, and I was quite miserable. I was glad to get it all over and done with.
I've had enough of it by December the 28th.
Definitely. I mean, the only good thing that got me through it was my daughter's first Christmas with her. She was only 5 weeks old, but it still, Christmas and New Year still got me irritated, though.
Give it another 3 years, and you'll not only be irritated, but very tired.
Probably will be. I'm trying to feel quite tired now, actually.
I bet you are.
She's worth everything.
Of course. How's her sleeping?
Yeah, not too bad. She was a bit bad when we first got her home from hospital, but she's settling down now, and Mum's doing really well. Mum's a great credit in the night and allows me to sleep so I can come to work and be refreshed.
Is she breast or breast and bottle?
We started off with breast, but unfortunately it didn't kind of work out. So we're on to bottle now.
Don't worry about it.
But that's good, because that means I can do my bit.
That's exactly right. Both of my boys were bottle, and they're good strapping lads.
Mm.
And it does mean, that you can do your turn.
That's right.
And that's important.
Give her a bit of a break as well.
Of course, and they need that.
They do.
And I'll tell you a poignant sight, which you're going to start getting used to. 5:30 on a Sunday morning.
Right.
You get all these men out in push with their push chairs.
Right.
And they're giving their wife a break.
Ah.
Letting her have a couple of good hours.
5:30 in the morning.
When it's light.
Mm.
And what we do is we do it then because we know that we can get some papers on the way home.
Yeah.
And with any luck, there'll be a slice of toast and a cup of coffee waiting for us, but there never is.
No, this is true. That'd be quite nice going along Worthing Seafront like that in the early hours.
There'll be loads of you, man. Loads of you.
Yeah, that'd be really cool.
All right, well,
have fun.
Yeah,
it'd be really good.
Keep us posted.
I will do.
Maybe give us a call during the wonderful hour. You could just with some little observations about your daughter.
Yeah, brilliant.
All right.
Look forward to it.
Cheers.
Thanks, Tommy.
Nice lad. So there's David. He has offered to help out Jenny Day, who's found herself irritable because they spent a lot of money on a television set, only to discover it doesn't have a single knob on it. Well, probably just an on-off button. A standby button. And they can't make the remote work, so I can only presume it's locked on Channel 4 or whatever it was they were watching when the remote control went belly up. JJ emails, I was sent to a non-private school. I'm now mostly self-taught. A thirst for knowledge and a desire for truth comes to many of us, but unfortunately not all. I would love to now take my knowledge back to school and confront the teachers who taught what they thought was useful information, when it actually turns out that most of it is useless and just clogs the minds of young children. Self-sufficient skills need to be taught, such as engineering, farming, electronics, building skills, etc. By the way, Jenny could buy one of those one-for-all remote controls, about 15 to 20 quid. They work on all TVs. That is a very good tip. Thank you for that. I will pass it on.
BBC Southern Counties Radio. The sound of Sussex.
We've got that nice James Blunt in just a few seconds, but hi, it's Di again. Email, drivers who don't know how to use roundabouts are extremely irritating and whose cars appear not to be fitted with indicators. It's the irritable hour. BBC Southern Counties Radio, 08459 570057.
melt on. Melt with the stars again. Do you remember the day when my journey began? Will you remember the end of time? Beautiful dawn, you're just blowing my mind again. Thought I was born to endless night until you shine.
Blunt on the afternoon show, BBC Southern Counties Radio. 8 minutes to four. Let's squeeze in a couple more irritable people if we can. Andy from Worthing. Actually, Andy, you want to help?
Yeah. I'm up at top of good. I'm at top of Goodwood at the moment. The signal sounds rubbish, but there's a bell on the phone. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Right, remote controls. You know, yeah. That somebody said about getting one that does everything. Don't do it. I've bought them 3 times.
Yeah.
The remote controls, it does everything. It does everything by the one you want to do it on. I'll tell you that.
Isn't that life?
That is guaranteed. You still there?
Yeah, what are you doing up at Goodwood then?
Well, no, I've been over to Hampshire to look at some jobs.
Okay.
You know, have a bit of a jolly, really. You know, measure up some jobs in that. And then I've got a chauffeur with me. We're just going to stop and have a little... We're going to go to the Georgia Eartham.
Oh,
and
yes,
have a pint. But my missus is with me today, so she can drive home for me, I see.
How nice a pair
now,
of you.
How about we do it? No, the blokes are back at work listening to me. They'll be on the irritable hour now. They got to work till 5 and I'm going in the pub.
You'll be in the pub. You'll be well gone before they actually get to their beans on toast.
That, two or three.
Well, it's only a Monday, isn't it? We don't want to go.
That's your part of the world, isn't it, Goodwood?
Yeah, Chichester love it. Way. Oh, I can see it from the window. Yeah, love it.
Yeah, no, we walked around the walls, Chichester there yesterday. We like having a little wander around the shops and having a look at the walls and that, you know.
Chichester's very sweet, isn't it?
Ah, it's a lovely place.
It is a lovely place. I agree with you. Well, thank you for your contribution.
It's foggy anyway. Be careful going up. Oh, it's foggy now.
It is, yeah. I've got to rush
back
anyway.
I'm just along the top, you know, just missing the 27, you know.
It's a lovely journey. It's a beautiful...
Anyway, you keep out a good work.
And you,
right.
Fella Andy, nice talking to you. That's Andy. And he says, don't bother with those remote controls that claim that they can control everything because they can, except the thing you need them to do. It's the Irritable Hour. We've got Pim on the line from Wadhurst. Hello, Pim.
Hi, Tommy.
What's irritating you at the moment?
Well, I just feel that I need a huge box with a great big sense of humour in it, because I've been onto Sky Television over the last 10 days to try and get a picture. And I keep getting engineers who come and tell me this is wrong and this is wrong, and then they go away. We'll allow it at least 3 hours, and then it will all sort itself out, because by the time it goes through to the control room,
mm-hmm.
and then it will work. And sure enough, it doesn't.
No. What happens? Does the screen go wiggly?
Nothing, yes.
Nothing?
I get these sort of, I don't know what you call them, where all the picture breaks up.
Yeah, pixelates and everything.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Or I get put in your PIN, or you can't view this.
Yeah.
What else have I had? Quite a few, so many I can't really remember. It's a bit like playing darts.
And when you have been able to get it, you can't get all the channels that you're supposed to.
No.
No?
No. And then when they send somebody, they each give me a different problem.
Yeah. They all say, oh, well, you know what that is, don't you, love?
Yes. And the thing I love more than anything is wait 3 hours and it'll work.
I've not come across that one, but obviously you've had it more than once.
Just a few.
I'll tell you what, I bet your cheques are still being collected to pay for it.
Exactly. You know, 58 minutes, 40-something minutes, and I'm paying for the call. And if you do get through the last but one call, I actually got through. It was 52 minutes. I got an answer. I got somebody that spoke to me.
Yeah.
And then when I'd given my name and my address, the line went dead.
And you had to start all over again.
Can you believe that? Well, I couldn't, I went and had a glass of wine. I mean, gosh.
Or three.
Yes.
You end up thinking to yourself, well, maybe I might as well just stick with the terrestrial boys. At least you managed to get a signal out of that funny piece of wire.
Well, I did actually try and cancel it. I got so worked up.
Yeah.
I thought, well, this really isn't doing my health any good. And I said, I want to speak to the manager. Well, apparently they haven't got any managers. So I said, well, how can I cancel it? Well, can you hold on again?
I must say, I think you're doing very well, because I would be talking like this if I was you. Do you know what I mean?
I wouldn't if I wasn't on the radio, believe me.
Well, I hope it gets sorted out one way or another, Pen.
Thanks a lot.
If not, you just have to stick with the radio.
Well, yes. I don't know how you get through to them. I wish I had a broomstick. I'd fly over there.
it's a distracting thought. Thank you, Pen.
All right. Bless you.
Bye. Bye-bye. This has been the Irritable Hour. Stand by for Drive.